Also.
Got it.
People should know.
People
should know that people in this country are taking a stand against this.
Thank you.
Yay.
What are you doing right now?
Hi, sir.
Includes amazing organizations like the San Francisco Projection Organizations and the Bill of Rights Defense Committee asked me to come and moderate this event. I'm going to give a couple of brief comments and then I'm going to introduce the other speakers. I'm Rainey Reitman. I'm the Activism Director of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. As some of you may know, EFF organized, along with other organizations including Demand Progress and organizations around the world, a global day of action against NSA spying abuses. And that took place today. And we had a huge number of people participate. We had over 6,000 websites install a widget on their websites. And through this widget, people were able to contact their members of Congress and demand an end to mass surveillance. This guy right here did it. So what does that mean? This guy, everybody, I'm so glad. What's your name? Nicholas. Thank you, Nicholas. Nicholas and 69,999 other people called their members of Congress today and told them that we were not going to stand for this type of surveillance and it has to end. This was huge. I mean, can you imagine 70,000 different phone calls? People were telling me all day, I couldn't get through. I kept calling Dianne Feinstein, and it was a busy signal. I, Rainey Reitman, tried to call Senator Feinstein and got a busy signal just a few hours ago. So it was an amazing day. In addition to 70,000 phone calls today, we were able to garner well over 100,000 emails to members of Congress, and we also had more than 200,000 people from around the world, mostly people outside of the United States, signed on to a global petition that was a legal framework demanding an end to mass suspicionless surveillance. So thank you everybody who helped with those initiatives. So that was the basis of the Day We Fight Back. We put together this huge online action. We wanted to do something as big as SOPA to say, hey, this is our internet. We're going to fight for it. We're going to defend it. We're going to make sure that you can't constantly surveil us and turn the internet that we use to communicate and connect into basically a device that you use to surveil us and chill our free speech. So we decided we were going to have an online action. And then all of a sudden, even though we didn't even ask for it, people all over the world started throwing together in-person protests so that there were crypto parties, and there were protests like this, and there were people painting murals in Latin America about surveillance, and there's everybody all over the world throwing together events just like this. And I'm incredibly glad to be able to be in San Francisco, one of dozens of events worldwide pushing back against mass surveillance. So thank you guys for coming out for it. The legislative act. So people are a lot of like, okay, what's all this about? We're pushing for reform. What does that look like? Reform looks like a lot of different things. It looks like legislative change. And the bill that's moving right now in Congress that has a chance is called the USA Freedom Act. This is a very moderate bill that would try to pull in mass surveillance by the NSA. So to say the NSA doesn't have the right to collect all of our phone records of millions of law-abiding Americans. And would also make a number of strong changes to the FISA court. Now that's the court that has been signing off on all of the surveillance orders that the NSA is using to justify the mass collection of information of law-abiding Americans and people all around the world who haven't done anything wrong. I would do a couple things. Would it go far enough? It totally would not protect our basic security online. One of the things that the NSA is doing is they're undermining computer security. Now let me be super clear for people who don't understand this. This is the security that we use for everything that involves computers. And computers aren't everything now. They are how we do finance. They are how we do transportation. Everything, including like aircraft control. It's everything including medicine. You cannot undermine basic security for computers without undermining it for everybody. It is making us all less safe. These are things that are not addressed in the legislative proposals now. Now many people think, well, what is Senator Dianne Feinstein doing to represent the good people of California on this issue? I'll tell you what she is doing. Yes. Dianne Feinstein has decided to promote a bill called the FISA Improvements Act. You might think, oh, the FISA Improvements Act. Isn't that going to improve the FISA courts? It does not. This is a bill that attempts to legalize mass surveillance by the National Security Agency. It's a bill that is trying to codify into law everything that we're out here in the street protesting today. That's our senator. So, the Electronic Frontier Foundation has been fighting this issue for years. We've been in the court system fighting the national security abuses as a violation of our constitutional rights, of your constitutional rights, since 2006. And I'm very happy to say that our court cases are moving forward. While many court cases about NSA surveillance have been thrown out for lack of standing, the Electronic Frontier Foundation's cases are moving forward. We've got two active cases right now. One saying that internet surveillance programs violate the Fourth Amendment, and one that says that it violates the telephone metadata program violates our First Amendment rights of association. And I am incredibly glad to be here tonight because we have a very, very special guest. We have 2 days, two talks to this crowd on this very special occasion at this very special place. Mark Klein, the whistleblower. So for those of you who don't know, Mark Klein is the whistleblower who came to the Electronic Frontier Foundation many years ago, and his documents that he provided to us were the basis of our 2006 lawsuit that we used to sue AT&T. Mark Klein worked in this building. He worked right up here. And he's going to come up here and he's going to talk to you about what it was that he was able to uncover and how that became the basis of really many years of fighting, not only for more transparency about what the National Security Agency is doing and collecting, but ultimately the movement that is working to end mass suspicionless surveillance. I want to welcome Mark Klein. He's been an incredible inspiration to whistleblowers and to all of us working in civil liberties. Please come up here, Mark Klein.
This takes me back. I retired in 2004. In 2003, I was assigned to this building. And I had already heard, before I arrived here, that there was a secret room being built for the NSA. and only one guy could get in that room. And he was the guy who had been interviewed by the NSA. And already pissed off a lot of people because he was working with equipment that us union technicians were supposed to work with. When I arrived, I was assigned by happenstance to the internet room. And gradually, over weeks, I found some documents and I found some equipment that the previous technician pointed out to me. And what I found was this, that the NSA had installed splitters, which are basically glass prisms that split the light beam, laser light beam, that carries the internet data. And by splitting the beam, they were basically copying all the data flowing across the internet in that room. And that data went to their secret room, and then it went on to who knows where, probably the NSA headquarters or other storage facilities. And my job was partly to connect new circuits to the splitter cabinet. So I was basically, and I knew right away what I was doing, I was wiring up the Big Brother machine, which pissed me off. Wiring up the Big Brother machine. And I knew right away that what they were doing was totally legal. Because I remember in the 70s, and I remember high school constitution where you were introduced to the 10 amendments, and the 4th amendment said that they had to get a warrant and get probable cause to collect specific things on specific people. They had to name specific people and places and things that they could collect and had to be signed by a judge on a warrant. And that's the 4th Amendment. And I knew looking at the splitter that was totally illegal, because the splitter is basically a dumb piece of equipment that just sweeps up everything blindly without any warrants. So I knew that was completely unconstitutional right off the bat. But that was my job, and I needed my job. I was in my late 50s, and you can't come screaming, hey, this is unconstitutional, and then bam, you find you're fired. So, but I made note of this. It was clearly unconstitutional. And so, gradually, I collected these documents, which documented how it was wired up. The documents showed that they were copying internet data and sending it to this secret room. And then in 2004, as I said, I retired. But I thought, well, wait a minute, I should take those documents with me. Maybe I can show them to somebody. So, another year and a half. They didn't do anything for me, year and a half. This is a scary time. President Bush had already put into the military brig, without any charges, an American citizen arrested on American soil, and they threw him in a brig without charges. That was Jose Padilla. So I was scared. I was afraid to do anything. But I had these documents. And in December 2005, the New York Times published an article exposing that the phone companies were involved in warrantless eavesdropping. And I saw that, and I knew right away, I have the evidence. I have the documents. I can bring this out. So in January 2006, I brought the documents to the Electronic Frontier Foundation. And after some talking and so forth, they took the documents and joined it to the lawsuit that they already had going against AT&T. So we're off and running. So another thing I did, well, wait a minute, I'm a California see these documents and should know what to do with them. Well, guess what? Senator Feinstein would not talk to me. She wouldn't even talk to my lawyer. To this day, she never said a word to me. And it's become clear over the years that the reason is she knows all about it and wanted to keep it a secret. She's been functioning as an agent of the NSA all this time, trying to keep it a secret. That's what Senator Feinstein does. She protects the NSA from any political embarrassment. And she knows that they've been violating the law and the Constitution. So, we went to Congress. So we tried to go to Congress, and Congress's reaction was to generate a bill, and Feinstein was the spearhead of this bill, to not to make this illegal, but to give protection to the vote numbers. This was a bill that President Bush wanted, because Bush knew if our lawsuit went forward, he would be exposed, because the trail led to the White House. So Bush wanted a bill to give retroactive immunity to the phone companies. And Feinstein led the charge to get this bill passed. It took 2 years, from 2006 to 2008. And we fought it. We went to Congress and lobbied against it. And in the end, and I might add, in 2007, it was a Democratic Congress. The Democratic Congress was no help at all. No committee of Congress, and this was a Democratic Congress, no committee of Congress invited me to testify. Why? They were protecting the NSA, along with George Bush. So in 2008, finally, the bill was finally passed with the help of Barack Obama, who was then a senator, and had vowed to fight the bill, but at the last minute, he switched sides and helped pass the immunity bill for the NSA. So what did that tell you? That told you both parties have been in on this. Both parties want to protect the NSA. They don't want to expose the NSA or stop the illegal stuff. And that's what's been going on. So that quieted it down for a couple of years. Then along came Clinton. We even can't be dismissed as a nobody who was just making up stories with documents. My documents were not NSA documents, but Ed Snowden had NSA documents. They couldn't dismiss that. That's blown them out of the water. Snowden's documents have revealed without question that they've been involved in illegal spying. And now Congress is trying to cover their ass with the pretense of reform. So you have two bills competing for the mantle of reform. One of them, Grady referred to, that was Feinstein's bill, which is just an insult. Feinstein is continuing our method when they get caught out. Our method is, that's a legal tool? She'll make it legal. She did that in her bill. Everything that we found in some of her bills, Feinstein tried to make our bill. Okay, this is legal. That's Feinstein's bill. It's a fraud. Then we got Simpson Brenner Feinstein's bill. That tinkers a little around the edges. Maybe by putting some constraint on the collection of phone call data. You know, who's calling who? Well, if it was any constraint, that would be nice. But the Simpson Brenner bill does nothing about the mass bulk data collection of internet data. The secret rooms and the sweaters. Simpson Brenner bill does nothing about that. So that in itself is just unaddressed and not really
values. The guy who initially discovered the this guy here, yeah, he worked here.
Thank you.
a huge influence in my life and has taught me incredible things about activism. He's had 35 years of doing activism here in San Francisco and around the world. And I went to him several months ago and I said, I'm really excited. We were talking about throwing a rally in Washington, D.C. against mass surveillance. And I can't do this without you. I need you to come and help me make this possible. And thanks to him, we have all of these beautiful signs that are calling for the end of mass surveillance. We have a beautiful parachute. He is the graphic artist of the revolution.
Take a photo with photos and videos
of events all over the world and put online to showcase that this wasn't just an online protest, but also a physical protest. Please join your hands together and welcome David Solnit.
We will fight back. So, as Randy said, we're going to do a group photo. There's people in Brazil. We're all projecting a giant eyeball you might have seen. So what we're looking for is, this is a group photo, so we want actually everybody to come towards me and face outwards and squish in as possible. If folks holding these signs, and thanks to the Bay Area Light Brigade for the illuminated LED signs.
So if I say NSA says wiretap, will you say, "We will fight back," and mean it? NSA says wiretap.
We will fight back.
NSA says wiretap.
We will fight back.
ATT lets them wiretap.
We will fight back.
NSA says wiretap.
We will fight back.
We wanted to actually read a few of the rights that we're here fighting for when we're done. So let's just do it. Let's do it three times and see if we can actually do it so we can vibrate the sixth floor and shake some of those connections loose. That loud, okay? NSA says wiretap!
We will fight back!
NSA says wiretap!
We will fight back!
NSA says wiretap!
We will fight back!
So, you can check on the event page. Folks in New York, Brazil, Baltimore, all over the country, there's projection groups like ours. I work with San Francisco Projection Department with Julie, Reed, and Lisa, who through contributions from our community, bought some equipment, and it's been a fantasy to actually project the truth on this building where our Constitution is being destroyed. So thank you for fulfilling our fantasy.
We will fight back!
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 So I'm going to ask everybody now, we wanted to let our communities know, but also the folks inside. These are some rare documents that we think the people at AT&T and NSA have never seen. But we'd like to ask people who can see them to read them out loud together. So this is, slowly and clearly. Congress shall make no law respecting or establishing a religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or of the right of the people to peaceably to assemble and to petition for a redress of grievances. First Amendment, Bill of Rights, U.S. Constitution. That's part of why we're here, and that's part of what they're trying to destroy upstairs. The other one we're here for. So, slowly and clearly so they can hear us. the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, effects, against the unreasonable searches, seizures, shall not be violated, and no warrant shall issue, but upon probable cause, supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the place to be searched, and the person or thing seized. Fourth Amendment, Bill of Rights, U.S. Constitution. So, we're here fighting for those two rights, and let's not forget, this country came from a place where those rights were trampled by an empire, and in resistance to that, we wrote another document, which if we don't get those first rights, we need to pay serious attention to. So let's, if folks can read this together, this is from the Declaration of Independence. So slowly and clearly. And this is the right to revolution. We hold these rights to be self-evident, that all people are created equal, that they are endowed by the Creator with certain inalienable rights, and among these, right, liberty and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among people, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is a right of the people to alter or abolish it, take a breath, and to institute the new government, raising its foundations, organizing its powers in such form as to them seem likely to affect their safety and happiness. Declaration of Independence, July 4th, 1776. So we're here to fight for our first, fight for our fourth, and if the NSA and the corporations like the AT&T back, don't back off. We have to remember we're a nation of rebels, and we will affirm our right to revolution. Is that right? What to the slave is your 4th of July? Lisa, can we jump back to the video?